Hello everyone, hope you guys are doing fine. I'm Karthike and this is ACES. In this video, we are going to talk about encryption and cryptography. As this is an introductory video, so we'll only be looking at the practical implications without diving deep into the mathematics of how things are working behind the scene. So here's the list of topics covered in this video. This PPT and a lot of references will be linked in the description below for you to check out. So, well, let's start with what is encryption. So, well, what encryption basically is, you take a piece of information and scramble it so that only the person who is expected to read it can unscramble it. So, for example, let's take my name Karthike. So, an easy way of encrypting it would be shifting every letter by 3 digits, like let's say K. So by shifting it by 3 digits, it will be N, and A will be D. So my name encrypted this way will be NDUWLNHB. Now, well, that doesn't really make a lot of sense to anyone looking at it, right? NDUWLNHB. So this is an encrypted version of my name, and this way of encrypting it, like by shifting it with a certain number of digits, it is called the CSS cipher, and this is one of the earliest known ciphers. So, well, what the term cipher basically means is an algorithm for encrypting a piece of information. And cryptography as a whole is the study of techniques for secure communication so that only the sender and the intended recipient can view the information. Now, talking about use cases. So encryption is widely used. Messaging applications like WhatsApp, Messenger, Signal all use encryption. It is used in web browsing, emails, banking, storing data and sensitive information. E-commerce websites like Amazon, Flipkart and all the HTTPS websites use encryption. If you want to transfer some sensitive data over the internet, you will be using encryption. Now, how it's done, that we will discuss in the next part. Okay, so now we are gonna look at the two major types of encryption, the symmetric encryption and asymmetric encryption. And we'll do that with the help of the Alice and Bob example. So let's say we have this girl Alice here, and she wants to send a message to her distant friend Bob over an insecure channel. Right, so this is the internet, and she will send this message to Bob on the insecure channel. Now let's say we have this guy Oscar here, and he has tapped into the network so he can see all the messages that Alice and Bob are sharing. So let's say Alice wants to send Bob some message like good morning, and now she sends this text good morning to Bob over this insecure channel. So what will happen is that the good morning text that she sends would go to both Oscar and Bob. Now here arises the problem. We do not want that message to be read by Oscar. We only want that message to be read by Bob. Like Alice has sent that message, she only wants Bob to read that. So what she needs to do here is employ a method of encrypting her messages so that only Bob can read them. So now Alice will try to implement asymmetric encryption over here. Now asymmetric encryption is like a lock and a key. So what she does is she puts a lock on her message. Like her original message was good morning, and she would put a lock on her message. By putting a lock on her message, it means that she encrypts her message. Now this lock can only be opened with a key. So here she had her text good morning, and what she did was she put a lock on her message, that means she encrypted it. And now her original message good morning would be converted into some string which would be generated by the encrypting function. So let's say her message good morning changed into some random XY124532. Now this is the text that would be sent to both Bob and Oscar. Now, in order to decipher this text and get good morning back from it, Bob and Oscar would require the private key used by Alice to encrypt
accept her message. So now this text XY, this encrypted cipher text, would be sent to both Bob and Oscar. So now instead of the good morning text that was being sent to Oscar, this encrypted text would be sent to him. Now here arises another problem. The thing is that Oscar will not be able to decipher this message, but same goes for Bob, as he doesn't have Alice's private key either, and nor does Oscar, so they won't be able to decrypt this message back to a readable form. Now Alice cannot send her private key to Bob over this channel, as if she sends the private key without encrypting it, both Oscar and Bob would get the private key and that would solve no problem. So this is where the public private key encryption, or as we call it, asymmetric encryption comes in, as it would solve this problem of key sharing. So in the public private key encryption, instead of having one private key and one lock, what we have here is like a mailbox, right? Like you have a mailbox in which everyone deposits their letters, and only the owner of the mailbox can open the mailbox and read those letters. Like only the one with the private key can open the lock. And this is how it works. The mailbox is your public key and you have its private key. In order to open the mailbox, you would require the key. So now instead of a lock and a private key, we have two keys here. The public key and the private key. Now the public key is public to everyone. Everyone can see your mailbox and everyone can deposit their letters, but only the person with the private key can open it. So in the same way, any message can be encrypted using the public key, but only can be decrypted using the private key. So now what Alice does is she sends her message, "Good morning, Bob," and uses Bob's public key to encrypt it. Sorry, I made a typo over here. It's not private key, it's public key. So Alice would use Bob's public key to encrypt her message, "Good morning, Bob." And now she would send this encrypted message over that channel. Now that encrypted message would be sent to both Oscar and Bob. Now Bob has the private key to unlock the message. So like the Bob has the private key to his mailbox, so he can open the encrypted message sent by Alice to him and decrypt it and read the contents, "Good morning." Whereas Oscar, he doesn't have Bob's private key, as Bob didn't share it to anyone. He only shared the public key, which cannot be used to decrypt a message, right? Like public key and private key are mathematically linked together. You can use the public key to only encrypt a message and not decrypt it. And the thing here is that the private key cannot be derived from the public key. So this is how the public private key encryption is implemented over here, and they can share their messages without sharing the private keys. In a similar fashion, Bob will use Alice's private public key to encrypt his messages, and Alice would use her private key to decrypt the messages sent by Bob. Now in this way, Oscar won't be able to read any, to decipher any messages that Alice and Bob are sharing. Like he could see the cipher text, but he won't be able to decrypt it. Now the problem with this asymmetric encryption is that it is very slow as compared to the symmetric encryption, where you just have a key and a lock. So what we do is we use the asymmetric encryption, public private key encryption, to encrypt the private keys of symmetric encryption. and now use those keys to encrypt and decrypt the messages. In this way, the encryption is achieved fast, and Oscar cannot understand anything they are sharing.
Okay, so now we are going to talk about hashing functions and hashing algorithms. So basically, what are hashing functions? So hashing functions are like a one-way encryption. Like it is a mathematical function that converts an input of any size to a string of a fixed length. Right now, for example, we will take an implementation here. So we have this SHA-256 algorithm. Now this is a very famous algorithm. This is used in Bitcoin, and we are going to talk about that stuff and later in this video. So now let's say we have some input like and we hash it. So we run the function, the SHA-256 hashing function, and create this hash. Now this hash is unique to this input, and it would be of a fixed length. Now it is 256 bit for this specific algorithm, and here it is in the hexadecimal format, so it will be 64 characters long. Now the special thing about a hashing algorithm is, like, if I make a small change to the input, like we remove the S and we remove the S and now we hash it again, the new input is completely different from the previous input. Like nearly all of the digits are different. Like here we had ACS and this was the output, and now we just remove the S and the hash is completely different. Now this is what makes these algorithms so effective for security purposes, and that is why these are so cool. Now, switching back to the PPT, few examples of hashing algorithms are MD5 algorithm, SHA-1, SHA-256, SHA-2, and LANMAN, etc. Like you can see the list over here. There are so many algorithms. And
Now moving on, uses of hash functions. Now hash functions are used for storing passwords in our database. Like you go to a website like Facebook, they don't know your password. They just store the hash of your passwords. Storing passwords as a plain text is a very bad practice when it comes to data security. Like there is a dedicated website called Plain Text Offender. You can check that out, and it stores the list of websites which store your password as a text. Like it's a really bad practice for data safety, and it is used for data integrity and making secure authentication possible. It is used in banking and Bitcoin, and all the cryptocurrencies use hashing functions. The blockchain use hash functions, and hash functions are widely used in a lot of things we use today.
Okay, now we are going to talk about a really awesome hashing algorithm, the SHA-256 algorithm. Now, this algorithm is the basis of Bitcoin, and this algorithm is used in banking and a lot of stuff. Now we have an advanced version, the SHA-512 version. A few things I would like to talk about this algorithm and most hashing algorithms for that sake. Like, two different inputs will always give two different outputs for a hashing algorithms. That, like, it is extremely unlikely that a collision happens. A collision means two different inputs have the same output. Like it is 1 in a 2 to the power of 256. Now it is a really big number. We are gonna talk about that, how big of a number 2 raised to power 256 is, but like it is next to none. It is unimaginably small. And one more thing, a minor change in the value of the string, like I showed you with that ACS, I just removed the S and the whole output changed completely. So this is called the avalanche effect or the butterfly effect. Now we are gonna look at the monstrosity of this number, 2 raised to power 256. So you can see how big of a number it is. Like I had to split it in two lines. Like I cannot read it to that. a few billion 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 billion, and like according to bitcoin.com, around 150 million tera hashes are performed per day. No, not per day, per second. And just for context, 1 tera hash is like 1000000000000 hashes, and 150 million of these per second are performed, like with the current mining industry. And if we mine it like trillions, trillion, trillion faster, like mining means like generating the SHA-256 hashes, and we do it like trillions of times faster, trillion, trillion, trillion times, it would still take the Earth this many years, right? Like 7,14,305, and this trillion, trillion years to brute force the SHA-256 hash. And I'm talking about one hash here. And like for context, the age of the universe is just 13 billion years, and this is like hundreds of times more time than the age of our universe. So this is how secure the SHA-256 algorithm is. Like with all the power of our Earth, like trying to decode a SHA-256 hash, it would take us like infinite amount of time. Like this is just infinite time. So thank you guys for watching this video. Do like, subscribe, and share, and hope to see you guys in our future videos.